It's been 5 years since the Tunisian leader Zine El Abidine Ben Ali was overthrown in a popular uprising. With a new constitution and free elections, the country's become a model of democratic progress. But where is post-revolution Tunisia heading today? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the programme today with me, Peter Dobbie. Now it's been 5 years since the beginning of Tunisia's revolution, a revolution that's been credited with setting off a wave of protests across the region and has come out of the so-called Arab Spring, known as its only success. Tunisians marked the day with celebrations at Carthage Palace, but not everyone was there. More than 30 political leaders have quit the ruling party, near Tunis, in the past week. That, many say, is evidence of a growing rift within the group. And some of those now opposition leaders boycotted the event. All of this happening as Tunisia's economy continues to struggle, and some human rights groups, including Amnesty International, say there's been a rise in repression as the government steps up security. So, is Tunisia slipping backwards? For Inside Story, our correspondent Hashim Ahalbara spoke to some people who've seen the country through its transition. He sets up our discussion today from the capital, Tunis.
Eileen Murray moved to Tunisia a few weeks before the start of the uprising. Since then, the political landscape has changed so dramatically that the World Bank, where she works, has had to shift strategy. She's been advising the government on implementing reforms to make Tunisia an attractive destination for foreign investors.
Tunisia's transition took more time than expected originally. When the revolution happened in 2011, the expectations were so high that Tunisia would change basically overnight. That has not been the case, and we cannot fault the Tunisians for that, because this transition and the way forward has been managed in a consensus-building manner.
Now that the political impasse has been overcome, the government aimed for an economic growth rate of 7%. But growth is expected to shrink to less than 1% this year, following a series of attacks targeting tourists and growing instability. Tunisians who had hopes the uprising would change their lives for the better are frustrated.
The government must improve living conditions, tackle unemployment, restore stability. These are our biggest concerns.
Before 2011, criticizing the government was a major offense. It's no longer the case now. In a country where 15% of the population is unemployed, the economy matters more than political reform.
The only benefit of the revolution is freedom of speech. We can talk about politics, openly criticize a president without fearing repercussion, but nothing has changed in my life.
The day of celebration on the anniversary of the revolution is being marred by uncertainty over the future. It's a reminder of Tunisia's uphill struggle to meet the growing demands of its people in poverty, those who started the 2010 revolution.
Compared to countries gripped by violence such as Syria, Libya and Yemen, Tunisia has managed a smooth transition to democracy. It has a vibrant parliament, free media and free elections. But for millions of Tunisians, poverty and instability remain the biggest threat to the country that started the Arab Spring. Hashim Ahalbara, Al Jazeera, for Inside Story, Tunis.
Okay, let's bring in our guests. Joining us today here, first in the studio, is Amel, an associate researcher at Grenoble University in Tunis, Youssef, a political analyst and specialist on North Africa, and in Lancaster in the UK, Simon Mabon. Simon is a lecturer at Lancaster University. He focuses on political transitions in the Middle East. Youssef, Cherif, coming to you first. Is Tunisia the only real survivor of what the Arab Spring was all about?
Yes, by no doubt, yes, it's the only survivor. When we see what's happening around, Clearly, Tunisia has been through through a bumpy road, but it is a car that is still running. So yes, Tunisia survived, but as you just said in the report that will be broadcasted earlier, there are a lot of issues, and there is some kind of skepticism among the population. There is a lot of lethargy in the political scene. In the economic situation did not improve, the security situation neither. So there are still a lot of issues. But again, when we compare it to the region, to the countries in the region, Tunisia is still booming as a democracy.
Simon Mabon in Lancaster, for you, what are the big issues?
Well, I think a couple of them have just been identified. There is, of course, a real balance that needs to be struck between human rights, between security and democracy. And figuring out that relationship between those three really important issues, I think, is essential in making sure that the dreams that were born 5 years ago continue to survive. And making sure that those three can interact in a way that people feel that they can flourish, that their lives can develop in a positive way, I think is essential. But it's possible.
Amel Boubekeur here in the studio with me in Doha. For you, what are the changes that go on the positive side and the changes that go on the negative side?
Well, at least what happened for the past 5 years in Tunisia shows us that bringing change, political change to a country, is about much more than just overthrowing a dictator. The opposition parties, the parties in power, they have focused a lot on the fact that, you know, Ben Ali gone, and that we were going to have a new country. I would say that something that has been that they have failed to think about so far is about what kind of new political culture they want to have, what kind of post-authoritarian culture, professional norms, participation of citizens can we promote in Tunisia. And actually, Tunisians today are less and less buying the official discourse about Tunisia as the only region success. They believe that their demands, at least for those who did the revolution, were about fighting corruption, against the disdain of the former regime's elite, against corruption. And if you ask them today in the streets, they will say that they are in the same situation. So really, I think that the most important question in such situations is really about, have we been able to promote a new political culture, new political norms? Are people able to participate differently? And unfortunately, there have been some changes, of course, but for the majority of Tunisians, that's not that significant.
And for you, Youssef Cherif, does that chime with where you think the country is at the moment? Because it's obviously, despite that half a decade has passed, it's obviously still very much in a place of precarious, very precarious transition.
No, it is very precarious. Again, Tunisia is faring well compared to the countries in the region, but in general, no, Tunisia is facing a lot of problems. But if we go to the pure, let's say, if you compare it to before 2011, people were not even involved in the political discussions, in the public sphere was totally accaparated by the regime that was in place. Some of the regime is still around today, but we have other players that emerged. We have a lot of discussions, debates. Anyone can criticize wherever is going wrong, but of course there is no solution yet. And because of the many problems that the country is facing, because of the economic situation that not a single government since Ben Ali, since the last years of Ben Ali, not a single government was able to solve, because of the security problems that are growing year after year, especially with the collapse of the Libyan state. Tunisia is now in a very precarious and fragile situation, sadly, it's sad to say it, but I don't see any upcoming government, or be it through elections, or even if there is a coup like what we've seen in Egypt, if we have that scenario as well, I don't see anyone or any kind of regime being able to solve Tunisia's problems from a day to the other. So what we have now, this shaky democracy, this fragile democracy, I think it's a little better than what our neighbors have, but it is still a road full of problems.
But I think actually what made it worse, it's really that Nahda and Nide, they agreed on a kind of common reintegration of the political scene, excluding all the revolutionaries, putting a kind of artificial, I mean, it had some roots within civil society, but it was still a superficial polarization between Islamist people and secular actors. And it allowed us to talk about the struggle between Islamists and secular, instead of talking about the participation of all those young guys who did the revolution. So this new regime that Tunisia has, this regime that I called bargained competition, it means that you actually choose your enemy. You choose the guy who is going to, who may actually cut you the road or cut you the access to power in order to ensure that you will be able to govern with them. And even if it's your intimate enemy, but still you're choosing the people who you want to govern with. And that's what happened between Nide and Nahda. And the problem is that really it marginalized all the other first, of course the left-wing parties first and foremost, but also civil society. And that's really the meaning of the struggle today in Tunisia. How people can reorient it, what is going on, this kind of consensus that is going on between Nahda and Nide, and that actually marginalize any kind of any political alternative for political change in the country.
Simon, that younger generation that Amel's talking about there, do they have honest, fair, trustworthy representation today, because we're 5 years into a process that's kind of mutating into being something else, if you will? And on top of that, if they don't have representation, will they get representation?
Well, I think that's a really difficult question. I think it's really important to really verify the extent to which their views are being represented accurately. And I think that they're in a really difficult position. We've got rising unemployment. We've got rising youth unemployment, economic challenges across the region. And as a consequence, I don't think these voices are being adequately heard. And from that, they don't feel like they're being represented accurately. I mean, I'm not Tunisian, obviously, and I wouldn't want to speak on behalf of the Tunisian people in any way, shape or form. But from my understandings and from the discussions that I've had, there are issues with this, and finding this correct form of political representation is increasingly difficult, because if it doesn't happen, then it will just lead to more and more disenfranchisement, more dissatisfaction with the status quo. And when we factor this into the broader regional context and the cross-state dynamics that are shaping the region right now, it's all too easy to see how people turn elsewhere to try and find answers to problems that should be solved at home but aren't being as yet.
Youssef, is that why 5,500 Tunisians, presumably young men, they're invariably between 18, 25, 30-ish, have gone to work for ISIL? Because on the outside the border, wherever you go, you've got Libya on one side, that's a failed state in effect, you've got Algeria on the other side, the economy is flatlining, and people, those young men that wanted something more, they think, well, I can't get it at home, so I'll go and work for ISIL.
That's one of the reasons, but I think the main reason why there are so many Tunisians who went to ISIS, to Daesh, is that Tunisians under Ben Ali, there was no sense of appartenance, of belonging to the Tunisian state. There was a total vacuum under Ben Ali, and Tunisians were just in an almost like the population, the youth population in general, they are in a kind of vegetative way of life. They had no political affiliations, no political culture, and so on. In 2011, with the revolution, this vacuum was very easily, very quickly filled by those who were ready to do it. And that we saw, first of all, the Islamists, who were, be it the moderate ones or the more or less radical ones, so the Salafis and so on. And then came the extremist and very radical ideology of Daesh that gave them actually privileges that they never dreamed of, that offered them offered them actually another ideology, offered them something to believe in, even though it's a mirage, even though it's something totally nonsense, but that's what it offered, this hope, even though it's a bloody and destructive hope. But that's what groups like Daesh offered to these young people who had no appartenance, and hence why we see so many of them going there. And because there are no solutions yet to the problems of Tunisia, and there is no political ideology that was able to bring hope to Tunisians, that alternative, that gloomy alternative that is Daesh, is still recruiting and getting sympathizers here in the country.
So, Simon, in effect, what Youssef seems to be saying is it was precarious and chaotic during the very beginning of the revolution, but why in the intervening 5 years, exactly 5 years, has the country not descended into chaos? Somebody, someplace, must be doing something right.
Yeah, I think so. And I think it's useful to look at this in a slightly different way, in the sense that over the past 5 years, there has been a degree of uncertainty for many young people in Tunisia. There's been a sense of chaos. The socioeconomic conditions that people are facing has meant that there's a degree of uncertainty as to what the future might hold. The lack of employment, the rising cost of living, just general economic challenges that people are facing means that it's a really precarious life. And I think one of the appeals that Daesh has and its message has is that it offers a degree of certainty, in that there's a certainty and a strength in the message that it puts out that contrasts with the precariousness and the uncertainty of life in Tunisia. And the same can be said for many of the people that are traveling to Syria and Iraq to go and fight with the group, from people in the region, but also from people in the West, these so-called foreign fighters, who are struggling to find a sense of identity, struggling to find a sense of belonging. And this is particularly the case in Tunisia, where there is this notion of political transition. And where there is this struggle for identity, a struggle to find the self, an existential struggle, if you will, then the strength of the Daesh message, I think, is really important and really quite appealing to some, despite, as Youssef saying, that it's a mirage and it's nonsense, it's bunk. But there is an appeal there, to some, of course. To others, I think that there has been a degree of success. There has been a transition. And transitions take time. You weren't going to remove the Ben Ali regime and all of the institutions of the state and reform the Tunisian state overnight. It would take a long amount of time. And given the context of the Maghreb, given the context within which Tunisia was operating, the porous borders, the smuggling, the economic challenges, the flows of ideas, of weapons, then this makes it really, really difficult for the transition to take place smoothly.
Amel, you've identified in your various writings over the past couple of months, you've already touched on this, those two big political parties that have come through the filter of Tunisian politics to date. Can they realistically balance security and the safety of the people? Mm-hmm. Can they pull that off as a double act?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. Of course, as academics, we are always much more interested on things that didn't work. But let's be fair to Tunisia and say that at least Tunisia is still a fascinating laboratory. And it's a perfect example or case study to understand what we can learn or what we can do in order to promote political change and security for all. Not only security has a tool to shut down demonstrators or people who are critical of the regime, is also one of the of a crucial issue in order to bring change. And I would say that's also the main reason why the state has not been able, and people in power have not been able, to reinvent the security policies that they have inherited from Ben Ali. So they need to reinvent that. They need to make people participate to anti-terrorist strategies, but not in a way that is just supporting the state and just in a way that is praising, you know, the parties in power, but really in investing in civil society. And as Youssef judiciously said it, in order to make people identify much more with their state, you also need not only to focus on security, but
also... So we're saying you need to make people stakeholders in their own country, in their own lives.
Definitely, and decentralization in that instance is crucial. We're going to have some municipal elections soon, we still don't know when, but actually it will be crucial to see how to see, sorry, how people are going to participate in other way. And we have many initiatives in Tunisia, people who are trying to reinvent politics outside of parties, outside of ideology, outside of this polarization, Islamist versus secular that I was mentioning. Actually, the young Tunisians really feel that it's something of the past, this polarization.
Simon, this is obviously a work in progress. That's what we've identified in the past 20 minutes of this program. If it's still a work in progress, what are the potential pitfalls over the coming years?
Well, I think there are a number of different pitfalls in a number of different directions. Clearly, there has to be this balance between human rights, security, and democracy. The state has a number of different responsibilities to ensure that basic needs of its people are met. And that has a whole range of different obligations, ranging from education to welfare, to medical care, and to security. So the state has to try and balance out all of these different responsibilities whilst not sort of encroaching on the others. So the immediate concern would be to try and increase security and make sure that individuals feel safe within the state. But that runs a risk of impacting on an individual's freedom, on the ability to engage in political action, in civil society groups, both formally and informally. And I think it's the informal emergence of political action that the previous guest was talking about that poses serious challenges with regard to security infringing on political action. So it's a delicate balancing act, and making sure that the state acts with a degree of restraint, but that it fulfills its obligations to its people, that's really important and really difficult to achieve.
Youssef, kick this forward for us. We've got these municipal elections that Amel was mentioning. We don't have a date for those as well, as you mentioned. But it seems to me at the moment there's little consensus, there's no grand plan, and no politician is being filtered through the system saying, I can do this because of X, Y, and Z.
Exactly. First of all, no, the municipal elections are still far away, maybe 2017, maybe 2018. It is still unclear. But one of the reasons why there is such uncertainty is that we have Ennahda as a political party, but on the other hand, we have Nia Tunis that is falling apart. And all the other political parties are still in a state of creation. They are being created now or being recreated or regrouped again. So we have a totally a changing political scene now in Tunisia. New political parties are emerging, new political movements, other movements that are not political, as Amel was mentioning. So we have actually a new political scene that is seeing the light. So for today, many politicians are claiming to be able to restore and to correct the situation, but people don't really believe in that because of what we've seen over the last 5 years. As I said earlier, there is a lot of skepticism, but there is space for the emergence of new political parties or new formations that may challenge the government, the current government and the current regime. But I think this is something we can maybe talk about better in the sixth commemoration of the Tunisian Revolution.
Arab Spring, as an expression, is kind of a lazy shorthand for a process that isn't over yet. Mm-hmm. But if you look at Egypt, one could argue and say, well, that has not ended well. Of course, Mr. Sisi would say otherwise. Look at Libya, disastrous for most people. Syria, utterly disastrous for most people. So do you believe in your heart of hearts that this will end well? Because people still have that desire for real political change, but there's nothing around it to coalesce with.
You know, Tunisia is a country that has a specific story with violence, a specific relationship to violence. And Tunisians have spent the last past years actually fearing that they will be brought back to chaos and that they will not be able to get along together. That's why they have been actually shy in putting ahead a new project of society. But I think that now, 5 years later, it's now first two challenges. First, to agree on a common narrative on the past, and it will go through transitional justice. Victims should be called as such, and people who are guilty should be also go through justice. And the second challenge will be to actually agree on a minimum common project of society. And as I said, the fact, the fear to be back to chaos, to see a national civil war, or the risk of a civil war is well behind the Tunisians now. So let's hope for the future that they will agree, of course, on a new project of society, a new way to bring political change in Tunisia, sure.
A compelling conversation. Thank you all very much. Thanks to all our guests today, Youssef, Cherif, Simon Mabon and Amel Boubekeur, who was here with me in the studio. The debate continues, of course, on our Facebook page, or you can tweet us at AJ Inside Story, or tweet me. You'll find me via AJ Dobbs or Peter Dobby 1. You can leave your comments on the programme's page of our website, aljazeera.com. From me, Peter Dobby, and everyone on the team here in Doha, thanks for your company. We'll do it all again at the same time tomorrow. See you then. Bye-bye for now.